From Microbe TV, this is TWEVO, This Week in Evolution, episode 35, recorded on September 18th, 2018. In Rack and Yellow, and you're listening to the podcast on the biology behind what makes us tick. Joining me today from Salt Lake City, Nels Eldy.
Hey, Vincent. Good to be here, and hello from Eldy Lab Studios.
Must be into the fall mode there, right?
Yeah, getting into the late summer, early fall. I did a little adventuring the last week or two. I rafted through Cataract Canyon.
Wow. Cataract. What a great name.
Yep. It's great. A few hours south of here, starting out of Moab, did a bunch of flat water rafting, and then we got into Cataract, which is some pretty iconic rapids. Water levels are super low right now, so it was kind of more technical. One guy fell out of the raft, but we all survived. So I'm happy to be back in the comfort of my podcasting studio here.
Going
to
be doing any traveling soon?
Yeah, actually, I'm coming your way at the end of the month. So I'm going to be at first at the Rocky Mountain Virology meeting, my lab. Few folks from my, do you know this one? Have you attended this one?
You know, I was invited for this fall, but I had a conflict.
Yeah, so I think Colin Parrish from Cornell is going to be there. Susan Weiss from Penn, a few others. It looks like a really spectacular lineup. Sonia Best. Anyway, so we're like three of my Labbies and I are going to rent a van and drive out there about 7 hours. This is in Colorado State's mountain campus. But then I'm going to hitch a ride with Colin down to Denver. My crew will drive back to Salt Lake, and then I'm flying out to NYC. So we should, after the show, as we're going through calendars, maybe we can see if we can connect for something in vivo.
All right, that would be good.
Early October. How about you? What's your calendar looking like? Are you teaching?
I am not teaching this fall. I have a lot of travel, though.
Okay.
I'm going to Belgium on Sunday for a double-stranded RNA virus meeting, and I'm going to do a TWIV with Harry Greenberg.
Interesting.
And the following week, I'm going out to Stanford for a seminar.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of October, we're going to Penn State Hershey for a couple of talks and a TWIV. In November, let's see, what's happening in November? Looks like I'm here for November. I have Raul Andino visiting at the end of November.
Oh, that should be fun.
I'm going to Zurich the first week of December for a seminar and a couple of TWIVs. Going to Madison in December as well.
Great virology capital up there.
I'm hoping to snag Roland Rookert for a TWIV. Do you know him?
Fantastic. Know the name.
Never met him, I guess, yeah.
Yeah.
I knew him early in my career. He was very helpful. He was active there as a picorna virologist. And he's retired now, but I'd love to get him back in town to do a TWIV about his career. So.
Yeah, that's a great idea. Get some of that recorded. Yeah. And some of the history, yeah. Yeah.
So that's my fall.
Sounds like a full menu.
It is.
Yeah.
I mean, it's... and there's more coming too, but I'd like, you know, people want me to go visit and talk about communication, maybe do a podcast. That's fine. I enjoy doing it.
That's great.
I like to talk to young people about, you know, science and communicating and all that's publishing, all that stuff that I think about a lot. So it's fun.
So in you're mentioning you've got some remnants of the hurricane.
Yeah.
Up your way. What's happening?
I guess it moved up inland, right, from the Carolinas, where it hit on Friday, I suppose. And it's just raining here. It's very cloudy, but incredibly humid. It's 60 or 70% humidity. So
wow, tropical.
It's still tropical. Wow. We had a lovely weekend. It was completely sunny. You know, as this thing hit land down south, it was completely sunny here. Mm-hmm. And just last night, it started raining. I suppose it's going to be over in a couple of days, probably. Nothing, no wind or anything like that. It's just
that's
rain.
Good. Yeah, sounds like some real flooding and related issues ongoing in Carolina these days.
Yeah, it's too bad, right?
Yep, absolutely. But, yep.
You know, it just it's a hurricane. It happens, right?
Yeah, true.
Let's get the weather here. We've got rain all day. Looks like it's clearing up Yeah, the rest of the week it's supposed to be, you know, kind of partly cloudy. So
it's okay. Sounds good. Well, I have to say, Vincent, I'm kind of excited for our paper today. We're heading back into plant evolution territory, one of our sub-themes here.
Mm-hmm.
The paper we're covering is called Repeated Translocation of a Gene Cassette Drives Sex Chromosome Turnover in Strawberries.
Well, I'm going to get hungry now.
That's right. Hopefully, by the end of the podcast, the next time you eat a strawberry, you'll think about it a little bit differently after we sort of
go under the hood. Are strawberries a model system? Or are they just cool to investigate?
I think cool to investigate. Mm-hmm. And in fact, this notion of model system, which, you know, goes back now, what, 50, 60, maybe even more years. I have some colleagues who are trying to sort of reframe or redefine this into this notion, not of models, non-models, but of just research organisms.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think it started with Drosophila, right? Because people had forgotten genetics. And then Thomas Hunt Morgan, I think, here at Columbia said, hey, the fly could be a good organism. You know, it reproduces quickly, got a lot of offspring. It's easy to score phenotypes. I think that was really the beginning. And people thought, yeah, there's some things that are pretty easy to study. So let's focus on them, right?
Yeah. No, that's right. I think it's really fascinating, too, to consider sort of which organisms kind of graduated into this territory that we'd traditionally describe as model systems, like you're saying, Drosophila, some of the others. And then, but what's, I think, even more interesting are the ones that sort of didn't make it. So, you know, around that same time, people were working like crazy with things like Paramecium. And then it never kind of got that same energy. Budding yeast came in and sort of displaced it as a unicellular model. But now again, with all of the tools we talk about, the genome scale analysis, the increasing reach of genetic modifications, now people are really returning to all of this diversity. And what an exciting time.
So you would say that you don't need to have model organisms because you could study everything now, right?
Don't get me wrong. So there really is, something to this notion of, you know, the decades of investment that many labs have made for the tools to really go deeper, right? The strains, the highly related variants, all of the genetic tools, and a community, people you can talk to and sort of cooperate with, that really does make a difference. So, yeah, while I'm on the one hand really excited about all of the kind of new possibilities looking forward, I definitely would not underestimate what all of those resources, what that investment means. That's really been pivotal in the advances that we've made scientifically from a genetic standpoint.
Well, also from a practical standpoint, if you say you find an organism, let's just say planaria for the heck. I don't think planaria are models, right?
Well, so that's foreshadowing my pick of the week. We'll get back to that.
I mean, just pick something that seems cool, but getting funded will be hard, right? Because there's nothing. I mean, and so you got yeast and C. elegans and Drosophila, where you have decades and decades of data, and you can build on that to get some preliminary data. But if you're just starting some cool organism that you think, oh, let's study this, you're going to have trouble getting funded unless you use some other funding to get going, right?
Sure. But that raises kind of the chicken and egg, right? So what about Thomas Hunt Morgan, right? When he started, he wasn't looking at all of the existing resources, sort of the this idea that your peers agree that this is an organism worth studying. He was saying, hey, what about this fruit fly? And so, you know, that's kind of, I think we're in this, you know, fun era of potentially new Thomas Hunt Morgans who have that vision and that energy to start to take something that doesn't have those resources, a research organism, and then to start to build that from scratch. And then, you know, in the next generation, this will be the equivalent of the Drosophila. We talked to early in one of our TWEVO episodes, Nicole King from Berkeley, who has been championing the coanoflagellates as a system to start to tackle the idea of the evolution of multicellularity. And, you know, I put her in that category of someone who's really pioneering a system. Yeah.
I think you have to be adventurous and brave. You know, you can't, I can't work on anything except my model because I don't have the money. You got to be brave. Take some risks. That's what science is about.
Yeah.
By the way, if you want to learn about Thomas Hunt in early fly days, you read Time, Love, Memory by Jonathan Weiner.
Yeah, great.
And I remember, and talks about how he started working on flies, and they didn't have any mutagenesis. They just produced a lot of enough so that now and then they'd get a mutant.
Yep, and the sports, and they were called, I
his
think. Yeah.
First one was a white-eyed fly, and he had one, and it was a little sickly, and he had to try and nurture it, of course, so he could breed it and so forth. And I remember his wife had a baby. She was in the hospital. He went to visit her, and she said, "How's the white-eyed fly?"
Great story.
Love it.
Love it. Yep. All right. Well, whether we're talking about a model system, a research organism, or a delicious snack.
But strawberries, Nels, people use in school to mix DNA, right?
That's yeah, good. True. Yeah. True. Yep. Yeah. So there's that technique, very simple technique, where you can actually, there's so much DNA readily precipitable that you can kind of see the DNA right before your eyes and that. Yep.
Yeah, so you spool it on a glass rod, right?
Exact. Yeah. 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 So that's where strawberries have certainly made an impact at the sort of educational level. And today we'll talk about them making an impact in the sex chromosome genome evolution level. So first off, the authors of the paper, this is coming from Tia Lynn Ashman's lab. She's located at University of Pittsburgh. So Vincent, we're right back at Pittsburgh. We were there last episode.
This department, biology, I got invited to go visit next year.
Yeah, I would highly recommend it. Great energy at Pittsburgh. In fact, I would say currently the science happening in Pittsburgh is probably better than the football. The Steelers, I think, are off to sort of a slow start. So the
you mean scientists football are, has started?
Scientists are carrying the load. The Ashman Lab, so this is evolutionary ecology. I haven't met Tia, but just looking at her website, you know, in addition to thinking about sex chromosome evolution, some other plant biology and ecology, they also think about, have some projects asking how pollinators influence interactions plant to plant and plant to microbe, including the spread of viruses. Mm. So some topics near and dear to our hearts. So Tia Lynn Ashman is the last author on the, senior author on the paper. First author is Jacob Tennyson. So he was, I think up until very recently at Oregon State University, and where he was an assistant professor for a little bit of my internet stalking, is now moving to Harvard, it appears. So sort of an east-west collaboration, but moving east. Also, I haven't met Jacob, but I do occasionally see him popping up on Twitter. His handle's at JacobPhD, and maybe he's most notable for some of his liberal use of emoticons to describe biological processes. So if you're on the Twitter, check out Jacob's account. Some really interesting stuff there, actually. So, and then I think there's another kind of senior lab, which is Aaron Liston's group, also at Oregon State, especially doing a lot with strawberry genetics in genomics. More recently. And so it sounds like this paper that we'll be talking about, sort of the next step building on years of work from these three groups. And, you know, Vincent, we have not talked a whole lot about sex on TWEVO.
No, we haven't,
And I think we're overdue, since this is obviously one of kind of the major pillars of evolution. How do genes go to the next generation? How do they persist? And, you know, just on its face, probably the easiest way forward is you just duplicate your chromosomes, duplicate your genome, your genetic material, and you divide. And in doing that, you've doubled the amount of DNA, and 100% of it, assuming no mutations, has been passed, in essence, to the next generation. But if we look at strawberries, as we'll be talking about, if we look at some other plants, if we look at most animals, and even some other critters, unicellular critters, there's all of this sex. There's mating going on. And that is actually a pretty massive compromise, since instead of 100% of your genes going forward, only half do, because you're sharing, as the gametes come together, you're sharing half of your genetic material with a partner. And so just from a very kind of simple view of evolution, this is something that probably shouldn't persist. You're basically, that's a massive trade-off, giving up half of your material at every mating. And so that has been thought about a lot. So Bill Hamilton, this is work stretching back to the 70s and others. This is the origins of the so-called Red Queen hypothesis that we have talked about a bit on TWEVO. We've mostly discussed this idea of, you know, so this is, again, Lewis Carroll's character from his book Through the Looking Glass, The Red Queen, who said to Alice, it takes all the running you can do just to stay in the same place. And so that hypothesis has been sort of co-opted by my lab and several others to think about this kind of evolutionary arms race between host and microbe. But actually, when the idea was first formulated, it wasn't thinking about host microbes at first. It was thinking about sex. Why would you put up with this paradox, this idea that you would, you know, sex would persist, although you're making this huge sort of reduction in passing your genetic material forward. And so some of those early ideas actually do draw back to the microbes. So the idea is that sex, when you mate, that your genetic material gets rearranged, recombination now becomes possible. And this allows for the diversification of your genetic material in a way that it's faster than the mutation rate. If you just start to scramble things, you can change more quickly. You can run faster from the Red Queen's sort of view. And so, but then why would you need to run faster to stay in the same place? And that's where the microbes start to come in. So this idea that the parasites, predator-prey scenarios, that these set up long-running genetic conflicts in the mismatch in mutation rates and population sizes, where you can imagine sort of massive advantages for the microbes, might be balanced out by the fact that animals or hosts, plants in some cases, use sex. And so at its source, it's all about the bugs that have driven then this these sort of massive bouts of evolution, and might explain why sex exists at all.
Yeah, there's a good book that describes a lot of the experiments leading to that conclusion. Red Queen by Matt Ridley. Have you read that?
I have. I think it's a great summary from a few years ago of some of that history and how this biology might sort of unfold.
Now, what's more successful if you look at numbers of organism, asexual or sexual reproduction? What do you think?
That's a good question. So I think it just depends on how you want to make that measurement. So if you're going on total biomass, I think the asexuals probably still do have right? Because so you just, when we think about all of the microbes, especially in marine, especially in marine environments,
right?
Correct. There's a reason they're doing a lot of running themselves. And have accrued these massive population sizes. And so it's almost this, unstable equilibrium of different strategies all persisting in some sort of level of balance.
Yeah, so they make lots of offspring. That's their solution to the predator issue, right?
Exactly. So, or being the prey. If we think of like of an immune system, like a predator in a sense, it's not a perfect analogy, but that's right. And so you can imagine that having high mutation rates, if we look at some of the viruses, another sort of corner of these conflicts as well, that then becomes a strategy that allows persistence, that you, if you can mutate fast enough, then that sort of goes up against sort of the the obstacles you might face from an immune system that's recombining. And sometimes, obviously, in real time, somatic hypermutation, right? The basis of a lot of our adaptive immunity, antibody-based responses, and being able to move not only between generations, but even within a single lifetime. So this continues to be a very active area of research. And I would say there's some really interesting kind of collaborative or knock-on effects, I should say, some issues that arise from, so once you've locked in having different parents, being committed to mating, then we see kind of new conflicts potentially emerging as these systems persist and evolve. One of these becomes a conflict over the investment in offspring. So just as sort of a general rule or some general observations, males in animals are sort of genetically predisposed in some ways to try to convince, biologically convince the female to invest more in the offspring. It makes it more likely that their genes will persist through the next generation, if the female really puts more and more energy, more effort, more investment into the offspring. On the other hand, the female might think, you know, this might not be my only offspring. And also, I might want to persist for a while too and start passing my genes into the next generation. And then we see sort of these almost evolutionary conversations written out molecularly and things like imprinting and controlling the expression of genes, all of this conflict over sexual reproduction, even among the same, you know, sort of partners. So things like sperm competition, which of the sperm is going to make it, development of the eggs through meiosis, conflicts emerging there. And so there's really lots of interesting sort of volatile biology that emerges when you sort of commit to sex.
Mm. Amazing that it survived, huh? I guess it's really useful.
Yeah, well, and yeah, it's worked. That doesn't mean that it's been sort of smooth and well-behaved. I mean, we almost, I think just as we grow up or think about sex, it seems like that's just part of who we are or what we are.
Mm.
But there are, as we look across nature, there are all of these exceptions, all of these experiments going on that are really fascinating. In fact, I think that's kind of gets us to what we'll be talking about today with strawberries.
Mm-hmm.
So before we kind of dive in there, I did want to just spend one moment just kind of thinking about some of the flexibility of mating that we can even see actually going back to thinking about, you know, some of these traditional model systems. So yeast, this idea that this unicellular organism can change mating types depending on the situation through this process, this endonuclease recombination-driven process between the alpha and A mating types. That's been well studied, and the molecular basis has been known for decades now. The ciliates, one of my favorite groups of critters, so things like Paramecium. When I was a PhD student, I was studying a sort of distant cousin of Paramecium called Tetrahymena that has 7 mating types. And we used to kind of joke around, you know, imagine like if ciliates had like a dating online dating app, like a match.com for ciliates, you'd have to have 7 mating types, right? That would be like, are you a 4 versus a 2 versus a 3? It just gets really crazy.
So you have to mate with a different mating type, right? That's how it works there?
That's correct. Yeah. But if you're mating type 1, you have 6 other mating types available to you. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so, yep. And those things end up being controlled by things like temperature, all of these different inputs, sort of environmental stressors that can really influence both the mating identity and also just the act of mating in a lot of these systems. So it's really wild. If you go kind of go beneath the surface, go beneath the hood and think about the evolution of sex, it's just all over the place with incredibly biological diversification.
I have a feeling we mentioned the 7 mating types before.
Did we? Probably.
Some Twigo episode. Yeah. It's familiar.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite kind of little tidbits of ciliate biology there.
So, Nels, here's the thing. This is a weird question, but you know, in a lot of organisms, sex has become pleasurable, right? But I don't know if it is for Tetrahymena. It probably doesn't mean anything. Like, why? Why is that? I don't get it. I mean, you know, it's like, and it's, I guess, culminates in humans, right? Where it's a whole culture surrounding it. But, you know, even apparently dogs and elephants, I guess they get some pleasure out of it. And that's probably part of the driver for mating. But as you go back the phylogenetic tree, you know, sometimes you have external fertilization, right?
And, yeah, that's right.
And, you know, that doesn't always work for all organisms, but and it's an interesting thing, right? Because it goes all the way down to quite, I don't want to call them primitive, but less.
No, all
less,
the way out, to you know, unicellular organisms, for example.
But it gets more complicated as, and when it comes to human, it like screws up the whole world, basically, right?
Yeah, well, Vincent, it's a great question. Maybe one better discussed over, you know, drinks at the bar.
Yeah, I mean, that's not, we're not a psychiatry or psychology podcast or anything. But, you know, from a biological viewpoint, it makes a lot of sense. But it has taken on such a life of its own, right?
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, I guess even in animals, you know, like they're alpha males and they're prides and they, you know, have dozens of harems, you know, it just, it seems way beyond what you need.
Yeah, well, and I think it certainly illustrates that sort of that central premise of evolution, that getting the genes into the next generation that a lot of things can happen when that sort of is put into place and life literally is evolving.
Yeah.
And all the complicated stuff that can emerge from that. And it's not, you know, I'd be a little careful to say it's sort of like the natural outcome or that, that, you know, the more complexity you add, the better. We see time and again in a lot of evolutionary sort of frameworks how complexity can just arise. It just worked. Yeah. That's what survived. And then you, and it's not necessarily the most efficient, the most streamlined, but it's there. It worked, and that's who survived. Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. It's just mind-boggling how in humans it has taken on so many lives of its own, right? And but you know, these bonobos, for example, I understand that if they have a conflict, they use sex to settle the conflicts, right? Stuff like that. So it, clearly things, peripheral issues arise in other organisms as well. It's just to the extreme with humans where it's just crazy, right?
Yeah, I have to confess, I'm blushing over here. As
well, I mean,
shy,
our politics is dominated by it, right? Men have been completely using it inappropriately for years for power purposes and all this stuff. I mean, here is, and it kind of bothers me because it's a biological thing that, as we've just said, it's needed to protect you against parasites, yet it has evolved into this god-awful thing where people misbehave, right?
That's right.
We don't have an answer. I'm just musing about...
Yeah. Nope, cheaters emerge. That's another theme of evolution. We see this in sort of all situations as well. Yep. Well, next time I'm in New York, maybe we'll have to grab a cocktail and really hash this out.
I'm sure we could have a good chat, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Mm. Okay, so let's talk about strawberries now, which turned out to be pretty crazy as well, at least at the genomic level, and sex chromosomes. So this becomes a really important concept, and I think this paper really nicely illustrates how sort of crazy or interesting the evolution of sex chromosomes can be. So we have a few terms here that we thought we might define. Should we do that up front, Vincent, or should we just kind of return to them as we're going through?
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. There's some words that I don't use on a daily basis here.
Yeah. All right, let's spend a minute to kind of decode a little bit of the terminology we'll use. So the first kind of term that comes up almost immediately is this idea of homomorphic chromosomes. Mm-hmm. So this, or just actually homomorphic traits.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is just the idea that there's between two different mating types, male, female, which is what we'll be talking about, which is certainly familiar for animals and even is used quite broadly for plants as well, for plants that do have different sexes. And the idea is that the sex chromosomes themselves are quite homomorphic. They're very similar between, in this case, the plants. And that's actually in pretty sharp contrast, I would say, to our own sex chromosomes, right? So the female X versus the male Y.
Right.
And that's another whole, I would not be surprised if we find ourselves in a future podcast discussing human sex chromosome evolution as well, because that's another obviously really vital and sort of vibrant area of ongoing research.
So that,
as well.
So that refers to the chromosomes, right?
Correct. And so the idea here is that, you know, so if you're going to set up a mating system with different mating types and rely on sex to pass along genes to the next generation, that you have to distinguish the mating types. And so that's become a sort of massive pursuit for a lot of biologists is to define what is it that's different about the chromosomes that makes one half or, you know, some number of your species female and the other half male or of different mating types, depending on the system. And so what this the idea of homomorphism is just that unlike the human chromosomes for plants, they're actually quite similar. And that actually becomes a big challenge for the strawberry paper is if the sex chromosomes are so similar between male and female, how do you really discern what makes one plant female and male from that genetic standpoint, that sort of basis of the genome evolution? And so part of this is our next term, sex-associated sequences, or also SDR. This comes up in the paper, I think, sex-determining regions. And these are thought to be the defining features on sex chromosomes, again, that distinguish the mating types, the males from the females. Mm-hmm. So for humans, there's a lot of active research on these, on a handful of genes. One is, I think, the SRY gene, which is a testis determining factor. Which obviously has it's involved in the regulation that sort of kicks off a whole set of physiological events that is involved in the formation of the testes for the males.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so that's found on the Y chromosome, missing in the X chromosome in females, one of these sex-determining regions, or SDRs. And so that's what we'll be talking about. But for strawberries, these species that the authors consider in particular are so-called octoploids, meaning they have eight sets of chromosomes. So most organisms we're familiar with and discuss are diploids. That's what we are. We have one set of chromosomes from mom, one from dad. Same for the strawberries, but multiply that by four. So you have eight sets. That also leads to some interesting biology as these things have become more polyploid over their evolutionary history. What's this next word? Diacy. I'm pronouncing that wrong, aren't I?
Diacy.
Diacy, yeah. So this idea of separate sexes, right, which is what, in not all plants, by the way, I think, and actually I don't know the number breakdown, but it might be that most plants are actually hermaphrodites. They can self-fertilize, meaning they contain both their male and female parts to do that.
Right. So they look the same, basically, right?
Correct. And so dioecy, or that sort of distinguishes, in this case, the plants that do fall into separate sexes. I'm always reminded, so, ginkgo trees are male and female. And the reason this is sort of firmly implanted in my memory is, are you familiar with the female ginkgo trees, like fruits, about this time of the year? Are there any on Columbia's campus, are there any female ginkgo trees?
I don't know.
So might you probably would if there were, because the reason being is that the female ginkgo drops her fruit at about this time of the year. As it sort of becomes rotten, it has this stench to it. It's almost somewhere between like dog shit and vomit.
It's wonderful. Wonderful.
Yeah, yeah. It's really pungent. It's so there are some beautiful old female ginkgo trees on the University of Chicago campus that I remember very well from my graduate training from stepping in that rotten fruit as I was walking past Botany Pond to go to the Ehrman building. And I'll never forget that ginkgo trees are males and females. And if you're in the market for a ginkgo tree, strong recommend for going for a male. So then you don't have to either dodge the female fruit or, you know, sort of protect your shoes from it.
Interesting.
Anyway, yeah, so that's what we'll be talking about. And then finally, you know, as we're discussing the SDRs, these sex-determining regions on chromosome 6 of the strawberries, this idea of homeologs, these are genes that at one point were separated as species as the strains, in this case of strawberries, diverged and became separate species, but then were brought back together during a process of becoming polyploid. So going from diploid to polyploid is sort of the reunion of genes that were sort of held separately. But then in the process of basically not going through a normal mating where you end up with, you know, the male and female gamete each donating one copy, when you're undergoing polyploidization, one of the common sort of outcomes is the male donates two copies, the female donates two copies, and you've just gone from diploid to tetraploid, and then do that again, and now we're up to octoploid. And so the idea for the strawberries is that most of the evolutionary history, or at least sort of not the most recent history, is that they were diploid hermaphrodites. That is, that they would undergo self-fertilization. Many strawberries still do that. Maybe the majority of them do. But then what the scientists in this study and others have described is that how some species are now actually separate sexes in their more recent evolution, and as we've been discussing, have become octoploid. And so those are the sort of the players for this paper are the strawberries that have undergone this sort of complicated genetics in their more recent past.
Okay. Well, there certainly were more words in this paper that I didn't know.
Yeah, so I agree. So, so the paper, it's publicly available, PLOS Biology. It's pretty thick. So I think it reads like a, you know, plant geneticist's I don't know, language in a sense. It's almost like a dialect. Yeah, it's really, you know, we just going through that sort of glossary, we probably picked maybe one out of five of the, you know, 20% of the sort of terms.
Yeah, it's hard because, you know, this is their field. And I wonder if we do the same, you
of
know?
Of course. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yep.
Because some of these paragraphs are just impenetrable.
That's right.
You know, I was reading it, and then I got to some where they just said, the gene has been duplicated. I go, whew, there, I get that.
I love it.
You know, especially
yeah, I agree.
You're talking about old cross data, right, and looking at the movement of the, oh my gosh, it's tough.
Yeah, it gets into the weeds, or into the strawberry patch, I guess you might say. But if we, I think what we can do is back out.
Yes.
And well, that's kind of why we do this in some ways, is to then summarize the main the main points. And really, you know, to break this down, what they did here was sequence a bunch more genomes. And so they weren't starting from scratch. So they're in work from the Ashman lab, also the Listen lab. They've done a lot of classical genetic mapping in other strawberry strains or a subset of the strains to start to get a handle on what are the SDRs, the sex-determining regions, or the in this case, the female unique regions. And so that wasn't like a black box when they started.
Right,
But very little known about the function or its evolution. And so that's where basically they took a deeper dive using genome scale sequencing of a number of different strains, male and female, to get a deeper understanding here. And so what they did relatively simply was just take 31 female plants, 29 male strawberry plants from five different lineages that have this octoploid nature. And then basically start, once they did all of that sequencing, some of the annotation, then they could compare them, and that actually kind of led to this really interesting and I would say novel insight about what's going on with these sex-determining regions, or at least some of them, certainly female unique regions in the genome, because they're absent in the 29 male plants, and how they've been evolving.
Nels, how do you tell a male from a female plant? Do you know?
I don't, but I think you can actually, so the flowers are slightly different. Yeah. And so I think you can type them just by that. And then, but you're right. So, you know, one of the, from a genetic level, obviously the simplest way to, without, you know, looking at someone from a genetic standpoint is to ask for the presence or absence of the Y chromosome. And so you should also be able to do that with these female unique regions. It's a, as we'll talk a little bit more detail, it's like a, they propose that this is a 13 kilobase cassette in the genome that's lacking in males. But you can even, I think from the morphology, there's, you know, different plant parts. Yeah.
Now, are these laboratory strains? Are they some wild strains in there? Do you know?
Yeah, I think it's more of the latter, more wild. So, and in fact, I think there's some East Coast strains that are original maybe to Virginia. And then some West Coast strains from in and around Oregon. So that sort of, again, unites the authors, this East to West Coast collaboration.
I used to grow strawberry plants in my garden.
Oh, I do currently.
But the rabbits eat them all, so I stopped.
I've got my strawberries are pretty weak, but I have one plant, and it's not even in the ground, it's in a pot. It's an alpine strawberry. That one does really well. That's like sort of my one success.
Do you have rabbits there?
We do, although not a ton of rabbits where I am. We have some raccoons and a lot of deer, and they've been, the deer in particular this summer they've been really in the mix.
Well, we put a fence around the garden, but the rabbits get through that, of course. And
oh, yeah, yep.
So anything that's low to the ground, the rabbits get. So we tried now some blueberries, and they're a little higher, but then the birds get them, you know.
Yep. Here we are back in the sort of genetic conflicts, the gardening conflicts.
How big is the strawberry
genome?
Are
in the arms race. Yeah, so I took a quick peek. I believe that strawberry genomes are about 5 gigabases at octoploidy. And so that would be nearly 2 human genomes if you're sequencing all 8 of the chromosomes, right? So if you could divide out, segregate out to one copy, then you could, you know, divide by eight. But these, at least in a diploid, would then be two copies. So that'd be more manageable. But at octoploidy, I believe, yeah, you're well past the size of the human genome.
So they have to do all eight copies when they're doing the sequence, basically, right?
Correct. Yeah, that's what's going on here. And in fact, that's part of the story, is that not all eight chromosomes are the same when it comes to these sex-determining regions. Okay, so, and, you know, again, this is something that's, you know, why this is an advance. This is, it's not until very recently that you could tackle, you know, 60 genomes at 5 gigabases as sort of a couple of labs teaming together. This would be, you know, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, this would be the Strawberry Genome Project would be bigger than the Human Genome Project. And yeah. It also illustrates just how far this technology.
This was in the news a long time ago, the Strawberry Genome Project. I remember that very distinctly. Now, Nels, what kind of technology are they using? Short read, long read, accurate, not accurate?
Yeah.
You're a maven of that stuff.
I've become more and more into it. That's right. So this, it's all short read. So it's all Illumina based. They do parens, so you can get a little more information out of that, and you know, start to get into things like haplotyping, linking genetic regions that are farther apart. But in general, you're doing short reads, so you're only sequencing, you know, 150, 300 base pairs at a time, and then doing this at massive depth. Some of the newer, you know, Illumina machines get you into the billions of reads now, and so you can start to build this at depth. We'll see that. This study, maybe we'll talk about a bit later, could use maybe some complementary long read sequencing to get a better footing on exactly what they're typing here. But already that you can learn a lot from going super deep with these, with this Illumina technology. And so what they were mostly, well, I don't know if they have other, I would assume they have other studies going, but what they ended up focusing on for this paper was to define that SDR a little more closely and from a comparative approach by having these five different lineages and representatives, more than one representative from each. What's the evolutionary sort of comparison or volatility of the sex-determining regions? And so they very quickly focus in, this is in figure two, on a what they call an SDR cassette. And this is 13... kilobases, so a small region, has two genes on it. It's kind of interesting. So the two genes, one is called, we're getting to alphabet soup here, but GMEW, this is a GDP mannose 3,5 epimerase 2 gene. The reason that's kind of interesting is that gene has actually been associated with fruit development from some functional studies in plants. And so maybe this is, because this is now for these strawberry species, this is just unique to the females, maybe there's some clue or some hint about how this gene might encode a function that makes a strawberry female from, you know, as distinct from a male. Pretty early days for, I think, understanding how that might really sort of be involved in this. The second gene is called PRR0W. It's a ribosomal protein, so a 60S acidic ribosomal protein, P0. And for that one, not clear if or what function it would have specifically for female plants.
And now, if you took this cassette and put it into, I don't know how you would do the experiment, because you start, if you want to make a transgenic plant, I think you start from cells, right?
Yeah.
Would it make the plant male? Is it enough, or is there something else that works, that works with it, right?
I think the answer is there's more going on here. And in fact, they hint at that in the paper. So, you know, they say that it's not clear that this is the whole story. There could be other regulators. There could be other SDR regions, actually, and that are hiding just in parts of the genome that they haven't annotated yet.
Yeah.
It's kind of an important bigger point, because when we talk about, you know, sequencing a genome as if we're done, the human genome isn't done. There's still areas that are not well defined. So especially repetitive regions near the centromeres, the middle of the chromosomes, the telomeres near the ends of the chromosomes, and other regions that are just really difficult, repetitive in different ways. We still have a lot of gaps in our knowledge about our own genome. And certainly there's even more in most other genomes, including the strawberries, where we've invested less attention. So my hunch would be that there is definitely more to the story here than those two genes, or as we'll see, some of the other flanking or associated genes with this cassette as it's moving through the mm-hmm. the sex chromosomes, the sixth chromosome of the strawberry. Okay, so then now that they had this female-specific cassette more clearly defined from their 60 genomes, what they could do is use, and they used just a core piece of it, I think maybe 1.2 kilobases, so 1,200 base pairs, which is more highly conserved among all of their comparisons. They used that to build a phylogenetic tree. So to ask, how do the species arrange relative to the identity in this region of DNA in these SDR cassettes? And so they do that. They build a phylogenetic tree, which we talk about a lot on TWEVO. This is figure 3. What they find is that, you know, so they sampled 5 lineages, but what they did is they were able to define 3 clades or associations of sequences just based on the SDR. So they named these alpha, beta, gamma, and then that starts to, they can see how those arrange, make some sense. So the most, what they think are the most closely related lineages, that's how these things cluster. And they use this to start to define the relationships between the SDRs. And this is where something kind of interesting emerged. And that came from when they went from just that cassette to look at the sequence, the neighboring sequence mm-hmm. around the cassette. And what they found is that it was different depending on the clade. So the alpha, beta, gamma, the 3 lineages, they had different neighboring sequences. And they gained that insight by doing what they're calling haplotype, or what's called haplotype analysis. That's what are the markers or the sequences that are linked nearby. Mm-hmm. And it ended up being different for the different clades. And so they now, in the next figure, expand that cassette to the neighboring sequence, which they call flanking or outer sequences. And basically they use those differences to build a case that they think these cassettes have been translocating or literally moving to different locations on chromosome 6 in the strawberry mm-hmm. genome. And this is like a cut and paste scenario that they're describing. So it's not like it's getting copied mm-hmm. into extra copies. It's sitting on one part of chromosome 6, and then it hops, cuts out, hops to another part, or translocates to another part. Mm-hmm. And I kind of like I did enjoy this terminology. They call those flanking regions mm-hmm. and sort of come along for the ride. They call those souvenir
yeah.
sequences. That's a pretty good, kind of a poetic description of what they're
right.
Observing. And so, and that would be the souvenir is that as these things cut and took a different piece of the surrounding sequence with it, yeah. then it lands in a different location. And you have these sort of newly defined sequences that actually, in a sense, grow bigger
yep.
as they take along some of that flanking sequence with it.
So the 13 KB stays the same, and then the flank gets bigger, right?
Exactly. That's exactly right. So that's kind of part of how they defined the cassette in the first place, is that was what was common to them all. And then they have these semi-unique regions around them, depending on the lineage that they sequenced.
Mm-hmm. And do these flanks have anything important in them?
Well, yeah. So that remains an open question. So just like, when they defined that cassette and then mm-hmm. identified those two genes, that's right. So if you look at the, and this is, I believe, figure 4. So this is sort of mm-hmm. A larger view around those cassettes. You can see, so in the flanking region, there's an uncharacterized protein. There's a inactive purple acid phosphatase gene. There's a glucosidase gene, beta glucosidase gene. And another one, there's a FBOX gene. So I think the answer is yes, there's more going on. What that means, are these just hitchhikers that are not encoding functions mm-hmm. or is that part of the story?
Yeah.
That's something that they speculate on. Mm. But so for all of the, kind of thick language in terminology in the plant genetics, a pretty simple story in the end. So that's about it. So
how many of these 13 KB are there? Just one per octoid? What's the word?
Octoploid.
Octoploid genome? Or are there multiple? Yeah. One.
No, it looks like just one. That's right.
As you said, it moves around. It doesn't actually get copied, right?
Yeah. Exactly. Yep. So that kind of gets into the next question, which is, this thing, they have pretty good evidence that this thing is moving,
mm-hmm.
copy and pasting. So then the question is, what's the mechanism? How does it move?
Right.
And so they have some speculation in the paper that it could be, and probably the most likely mechanism would be that transposons mm-hmm. are at work here. And in fact, if you look at those souvenir sequences, there are some signs of some repetitive stuff, some inverts, the kind of mm-hmm. shades of inverted terminal repeats. It very much looks like something consistent
yeah.
with the scars of transposition. We are in plants where transposons and retrotransposons are all over the place,
mm-hmm,
you know, can be 3/4 of the genome. So that seems like a pretty good speculation or a good place to look. And, you know, kind of an echo again of Barbara McClintock, right? I mean, she always, her pioneering work in identifying this idea of jumping genes. Here we are again. And it's hard to get away from that because it's so fundamental to plant right. biology.
Yeah. To most, right?
Yeah, that's right.
and they think the transposase comes from somewhere else, right? Because it doesn't encode it in these pieces of DNA.
Yeah, exactly. So if that's right. And so if it is a transposase, it's not directly linked. In some systems, you would see that, and that would, yeah, that gets yeah. to a very direct connection sort of between the selfish activity. Although here, since it's not copying and pasting, it's cutting and pasting,
mm-hmm.
they propose sort of a different adaptive hypothesis, which is that the translocation, so as you, what you'd imagine is that, you know, so here they're typing three different cases. What you'd imagine that this is happening all of the time in strawberry populations, and it's only the rare ones, these three, that sort of are the survivors, the ones that have made it. And so the question becomes, is that just, in one alternative hypothesis, it's neutral, this just happens. Mm-hmm. The sort of idea of genetic spandrels we talked about with Matt Hahn mm-hmm. a couple episodes ago, and that's that might be, you know, your null hypothesis in a sense, or as close to that as you can come. What they're proposing is, you know, this adaptive idea that in those rare cases where that cut and paste happens, if it lands next to a gene or it brings with it part of the genetic material to this new location, that somehow gives the female benefit. Mm. An adaptive advantage. And that could be, as we were discussing earlier, this, you know, this competition with males to invest in offspring. Is yeah. it the female, you know, like what's the balance there? Is it the female material at 50-50 with the male, or is the male sort of dominating? So if what these translocations could reflect are successful sort of counter moves or moves by the female plants to sort of keep themselves in the game, to keep their genetic mm-hmm. material mm-hmm. at a roughly 50-50 sort of, you know, cooperative, descent of the genetic material. And so then what's the kind of a knock-on effect or sort of supporting maybe a piece of indirect, at least, evidence is that because of that translocation, you get this really tight linkage between the cassette and then the genes that it's landing by.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're, and that then locks in, I think they have a name for this, their model. It's something like cut, lock, and grow.
Right. Right.
Yep. And so that's the idea that by growing, so randomly cutting and translocating, but then growing in ways that natural selection might see,
mm-hmm.
that might be reflected in that pattern of these translocations.
So do you think where this cassette lands, it makes a difference? It's important, whatever the surrounding genes are, for some providing yeah. some kind of advantage?
Yeah, that's the idea. And it could be both. So it's both in that act of cutting, what it takes with it from the flanks, and then in the landing,
yep.
the location it lands to, which would then influence sort of the next cut in land. So you, yeah, it could be. So again, this is this sort of process of diversification where you're kind of combining sort of an echo of recombination here, but just with the female, yeah. where it's combining yeah. its SDR, these sex-determining regions, in new ways. It's really interesting if you can, yeah.
So presumably these are jumping all over the place, and these are the ones that we're looking at that worked, right?
That's right. That's right, from this sample. And there yeah. might be many more, mm-hmm. But from this sample, it's, yeah. And so that's another, I think, really interesting question is sort of how frequent are these events for the three that they typed out of all of the different strains,
mm-hmm.
you know, what's the frequency of these things persisting? Is that, would you, and this might actually help to get at that hypothesis, whether it's neutral or not, is if you know the rate that these things happen at relatively randomly. Mm-hmm. If that's different from the numbers that you observe, that might start to give you a hint that this could be adaptive. You're basically selecting only on a subset of the many sort of mutations or translocations that happen. And so that might help to give some clues if they gain more footing on that. I also, as we were mentioning before, I think adding some long read technology that will just help with the annotation. So they're doing haplotype analysis to really define, even in higher detail, where are these sitting in the whole chromosome? What's in the neighborhood? What's directly linked or nearby? That might, I think, give a little more information, as well as just getting sort of a better handle on the whole genome annotation in general. The kind of mixing together of long reads with these very short reads can push the genome quality forward as well.
Right. By the way, there's one more word here, mm-hmm. and that's hemizygous, because they call this the hemizygous SDR cassette.
Yeah, and so that gets at that point that you made a few minutes earlier, Vincent, which is, are these like in 8 copies? And the answer is no. Yeah. So this, if you look at figure 5, which I think is a nice model that puts together sort of the ancestor as well as the the modern day guys, and it's showing all 8 chromosomes, and then you can see that translocation. They do these arrows, and it gets longer and longer as they kind of continue down time. And it's hemizygous in the sense that it's not in it's not in all of the chromosomes. It's just in this case 1 of 8, and it keeps moving. So I thought, and I won't belabor this, but maybe 2 broader take-home messages. One is, and you kind of hinted at this before, so thinking about how complicated human sexuality is, I think we often hear people, when we're talking about gender or sexuality, people will talk about, oh, well, just look at nature and there's sort of traditional roles for male, female. Mm-hmm. But I think that really misses the point. If you actually look at nature, like strawberries, for example, or tetrahymena, or other ciliates, paramecium, yeast, the idea of mating types becomes much more diverse and flexible. The number of mating systems out there, there's a ton of them, and it's really complicated. And so I think, let's step back and just acknowledge that things are complex and diverse. I think that actually comes closer to the biological reality around us. Second take-home message for me was, this, especially with food, the idea of genetically modified organisms and how worried and worked up people get at some of the technologies that are being deployed. This kind of feels like genetic GMO strawberries, but naturally speaking, right? So depending on which strain you pick up, it's going to have this cassette of 13 KB or more in a different chromosomal region.
Yeah, sure.
And yet, I don't think, and guess what? Guess what scientists are trying to do? Yeah. Take something like a 13 KB region and move it to a different part of the genome.
Yeah.
And so I think that starts to put into a little bit of context, maybe, we don't really bat an eyelash at eating a different strawberry. We're not worried about whether the SDR is in the left or right part of chromosome 6. And maybe that's closer to the reality with a lot of GMO scenarios as well.
Nature is the greatest genetic engineer.
There you go.
They're doing it all the time, and I don't know. I think we shouldn't worry about it.
Well, it's okay to worry about it. And certainly, obviously one difference is you're mixing and matching, for example, 13 KB regions are similar from different organisms, but it's all DNA. And I do think we need to try to dispel the idea or try to inform what's going on here. And just as you're saying, this is what nature does all the time. In fact, when we're talking about transposons, there also is, as a massive theme among crop species and other species, horizontal gene transfer, where actually material is going between two species. That's happening naturally as well. And so that's definitely an area that I think has gotten a little out of balance between the kind of mythology and the science behind it.
Oh, you can worry. But I talk about this with my younger son a lot. He says people are worried about what the genes are going to do, and therefore they should have a choice about what they eat. And I say, okay, but look, a lot of people are worried about vaccines, but I don't think we should give them a choice because that doesn't work that way. So, if you're making a modified plant to avoid using pesticides, it seems like a good trade-off, right?
Yeah, well, and I think especially if you step back and just look at the population growth of our species and how do you feed this mm-hmm. growing population. That's you. We aren't going to do it if we're sort of fixated on not doing genetic modification.
Mm. I mean, as Dixon will tell me, you know, all the rice you eat is already modified, genetically modified, right?
No, so that's right. Yep.
You're eating it. And so I don't know. I don't have a problem with it. I think the ideas are great, and I can't see the negative consequences. But I think you're right. We need to educate people better, and that's all about communication. It's not our job because we're not plant scientists, but I think the plant scientists need to do a little better job of communicating with the public and explaining what's going on and why it's okay and so forth. And they're not. Just like, you and I are doing this, but our scientists are also not communicating, and that's why they're anti-vaxxers, and climate people are not communicating and so forth. So
I think there's communication. It's just connecting. There is a disconnect, and that's it's complex. When humans get involved, things get complex, and we're seeing that as well. Where cheaters emerge, the message gets scrambled, what's real and what's not, that all can kind of become obscured very quickly.
Maybe you have to. I mean, I'm always surprised at how little people know. Like, we were talking yesterday, I was with some students, and they said they ran into someone who said, I don't believe in flu vaccine. But if you, and you might think as a scientist, oh, they must know something big, but they don't. They just say, oh, it causes autism, in which you can easily, talk to them and say, no, not really. But they think this is right, and it's just it's miscommunication or not connecting things properly, I guess. But I still think more of us need to talk and inform people around us, right? So
agree. Yep, agree.
Anyway, this is a cool paper. Very nice. Good pick.
Yeah, anytime we delve into plant evolution, it's almost always really interesting, fascinating biology.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we have had people call for plant papers, so there you go.
Yeah, thank you. we'll keep it on our radar, as usual.
Yep.
All right, should we hit the old mailbag?
Mailbag, you bet. Why don't you take the first one?
Okay, sounds good. So Nathan Clark writes, and he was the PI, senior author on our last episode of TWEVO 34. He says, thanks for featuring our study on PON1. I enjoyed the episode. I can answer a few of the questions that came up about this interesting enzyme. For starters, PON1 has been extensively studied in humans as well, and we generally have strong protective activity against chlorpyrifos and diazinon. Like you suggested, there are human alleles with differing activities, and so certain individuals are more susceptible. Interestingly, those same alleles are also associated with risk for atherosclerosis. Next, the high DNDS ratio in the bats and primates are intriguing to us, but we haven't been able to pin down the reason yet. Any ideas that you or your listeners have would be helpful. I hope all is well in Utah and in New York. So thanks, Nathan. Good to hear from you. And glad, actually, I don't know about you, Vincent, but I always get a little kind of nervous, like if the PI is listening to
us, of course.
Talk about
it. They're the ones to talk about it, right? Not us.
That's right. Yep. And I'm sure, knowing Nathan, he's also being a little polite in his generous words there. But glad we didn't do anything. Hopefully we didn't at least launch any dominant negative alleles where we were putting out misinformation.
So, now's the way I look at it is, PIs, they don't have enough time to tell us all the things
listen.
You said.
That's right. That's right. We can hide in plain sight with our long form podcast. That's right.
Why do you think these ratios are high in bats and primates? I don't know. Anybody have an idea? Yes. Send them to Nathan because
definitely. Why would there be rapid evolution sort of in repeated rapid evolution that is kind of the output of this high DNDS ratio? So the idea is that the non-synonymous amino acid substitutions are in a higher abundance than the silent ones. And that implies that there's rapid evolution happening with sort of functional consequences repeatedly.
Right. Really, I mean, you guys look for viruses that do that, right?
Yeah, correct. So that's a very common sort of symptom for a high DNDS is that you have a direct protein-protein interface with a virus, like say host immunity protein, where if you fix a non-synonymous or a amino acid altering mutation, that might evade inhibition by a virus protein, and then the virus will fix a mutation that reestablishes that interaction. You can see high DNDS as a consequence of that. So who knows what's hiding behind the biology there? It'll be I bet Nathan has some good ideas, and maybe we'll see that. Yeah, in the future. But if you think of anything, reach out to him.
All right, next one is also about episode 34 from Tom, Vincent, and Nels. In Tuivo episode 34, you had a short discussion and some questions about marine animals' sense of smell. It helps to think about this if you back up one level to see smell as one form of chemosensitivity. This groups smell and taste together. From that perspective, in an evolutionary context, smell in land animals probably emerged as taste sensors adapted for use in air. And also note that fishes have nostrils. Check out sharks' pictures. Nostrils on either side of the face taste slight differences in the environment, enabling mental mapping of scent taste sources, be it fish or fowl. Dorks are noted for their stereo sense of smell. So as marine animals evolved to live on land, they arrived with nostrils and apparently responded to evolutionary selection pressures that favored nostrils with chemosensitivity to airborne chemicals. The nose still maintains a damp environment to get the job done.
That's cool.
Yep. A digression. I've read that our experience of flavors depends more on our nostrils than our tongue. I get the impression that selection pressures favored mouths that could make quick, broad assessments of whether what we're about to swallow is safe, sweet, umami, needed right now, salt, or potentially dangerous, bitter. Our noses, meanwhile, provide a more nuanced assessment of exactly what we're eating or are walking through. Well, you know, if you hold your nose while you eat, sometimes your taste is blunted.
Yeah.
And sometimes you could have a respiratory infection, and it completely destroys your sense of taste. I had one in college, the only one I ever had.
Oh, wow.
I don't know what it was, some kind of cold. I couldn't taste anything.
Yeah.
And it was the weirdest. It was very disconcerting. Whatever I ate, I didn't know what it was, you know?
Yeah, I see this with my cat. So she had a bad respiratory infection not too long ago, and she stopped eating. And probably because she couldn't taste, and then she and
yeah, because that
she doesn't trust
defense. Yeah, doesn't trust the
that's
food.
Right. She, sure. And she doesn't, or her owner. That's right. Those connections are real.
Yep. All right. A final digression. Sensing and responding to the varying chemicals in one's surroundings is a trick that seems to be essential to all biological entities at all scales. One might, though, push this too far. Do cellular viral defenses smell the presence of viruses? Does DNA replication depend on tasting start and stop codons? Is quorum sensing based on the smell of the crowd? Probably not the best terminology. As always, I thoroughly enjoyed this episode of Tuivo. I especially appreciate Nels's ability to explain the more arcane aspects of evolution with readily understood analogies.
Thank you.
Now, stay tuned for this virus thing. I heard something at ASV that is kind of related to this.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, that there was a talk on it about, you know, maybe viruses being able to sense things from cells. So we'll see. Stay tuned. It should come out at some point.
Yeah. Well, and what it makes me think of is how folks are now training dogs, for example, to smell tumors.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's all of this. Yeah. There's all this sort of, you know, stereo smell, I guess, in this case, all this deeper sort of ability to do things that we might not expect. So,
yeah. And of course, quorum sensing is based on, it's chemosensation. It's a chemical that's produced, right? And there's a receptor for the chemical, and it has consequences. So you could look at it as taste or smell sensing, right?
Yeah. Interesting to think about that. Yeah.
Finally, a rant. I urge everyone listening to this podcast who hasn't yet done so, immediately set up a monthly donation to TWIV, he said, or you could be to Tuivo, to Microbe TV.
Mm-hmm.
You probably don't think twice about adding a dollar candy bar, a $1.50 soft drink to your weekly or bi-weekly grocery shopping cart. Do the world and your health a favor and set up an automatic Patreon contribution of that money. And when you're standing in the checkout line, remind yourself that you have already used that money to do something good for many and not do something bad for yourself. He says, feel free to read this rant on all the other podcasts. Looking forward to future TWIVs, Tom and Austin. Thank you, Tom. I appreciate it. We appreciate it.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks, Tom.
We met Tom in Austin when we were there for 500.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, he came.
Very cool.
He came.
Fantastic.
That's very cool.
This was Chris Sullivan sort of helped host this. Is that right?
He did. Oh, yeah.
UT Austin.
Shaker and mover, man. Without him.
Fantastic.
Wouldn't have happened. Yeah.
Yeah. No, thanks so much, Tom. Really appreciate your support. Okay. Ornab writes, hello, Vincent and Nels. This is Ornab from Bangladesh. I will start by thanking you once again for this lovely podcast that I look forward to every month. The recent episodes on neutral theory and convergent gene loss in marine mammals gave me a lot to think about. I don't know if this is entirely appropriate, but since you guys must peruse the wide field of evolutionary biology to pick out gems for the podcast, I wanted to ask you about researchers who are doing great work along the lines of Harmeet Mullick, Sarah Sawyer, and Nels himself, as well as the Neanderthal paper from Luis Barrero's lab that you guys did. Basically, labs that study the evolution of some aspect of immunity or host pathogen conflict and heavily use computational approaches to drive experimental strategies. I'm researching labs to figure out what departments to apply to for a PhD and would really appreciate your insight to make sure I'm not missing out on some great line of work. Apologies if the query is a little too broad, and thank you. Well, Ornab, first of all, thank you. I don't know, Vincent, these great letters, I'm getting suspicious that, you know, these are, who's really writing these? Are they, no, this is wonderful. And this is a very appropriate question, Ornab. And I would say, so all of those labs you listed are great. If you were, so Harmeet, the progeny, so to speak, of Harmeet's lab are spreading across the country in other locations as well. So I would add to your list, for example, Matt Doherty. Mm-hmm. He's at UC San Diego. I would also add Matt Barber. So he came out of my lab. He's now at University of Oregon in Eugene. Speaking of computational approaches, I would add Ed Chung. So he came out of my lab, co-advised by Cedric Fichat. It's another interesting lab up at Cornell, but Ed's lab just opened at Boulder, the Biofrontiers Institute, Colorado Boulder. And I would also add Dustin Hanks. So he came out of my lab and is now at UT Southwestern in the immunology department there, Laura Hooper's department. He's also kind of thinking along these lines. And so I would say, like, there's a lot of geographical distribution here, and I would say apply far, apply wide. A lot of these programs, so certainly for my own lab, for example, we accept PhD students through an umbrella program. Ours is the molecular biology program. If you're in any, so you can go to websites, but if you're in any doubt, just write an email directly to any lab that you think you might be interested in. PIs in general are very happy to point you in the right direction, as they're always on the lookout for interesting, creative folks like yourself. And so Luis Barrero, he just moved his lab. He was in Canada. He's now at the University of Chicago. And there's more out there. One other maybe word I'll put in, before, and I'll let you comment too, Vincent, but is, you know, not to really consider labs that are kind of up and coming, that are just getting started. I think especially as a PhD, aiming for a lab that is maybe a year or two old, it might sound a little bit risky, but because there's not as much of a track record. But these are people who are still very active in research. They're building their own research program. They're kind of there day in and day out to establish that, potentially a lot more one-on-one interaction and to kind of see on the ground level, what does it take to start an independent research program? And so I think I would sample broadly from early labs to, you know, not just sort of the famous, well-established labs, but ones that are up and coming, like the sort of list you're suggesting. And one of the great things, too, about almost all these programs at these universities is the ability to rotate and try out a couple of different labs, maybe three or four labs, before you actually decide, and kind of staying open-minded, keeping that flexibility. Certainly in my own experience, when I was pursuing my PhD, I just remember the sheer enjoyment of just bouncing from lab to lab, trying different things. I was in a plant lab, a Rhabdopsis lab, thinking about pollen tube migration. I was in a yeast lab thinking about protein modifications, and I was in a tetrahymena lab. I couldn't have predicted which one I would join beforehand, and there were some surprises along the way. And so it's really a fun time to sort of explore your own scientific style and interests. So staying open-minded would be my last sort of word.
Yeah, I think working with a young person is a great idea. I did that. I was Peter Polezi's first student.
Mm-hmm.
And I always tell people, look, you can get a lot of good out of that. And people tend to be wary of it. Don't be someone's first student. But if it's the right person, it's fine. And I told students that yesterday. I had lunch with a bunch of students at Mount Sinai and said, don't be afraid to be someone's first student. You know, do a little research, do a rotation, look into it, talk to people. But it's fine. It could be fine.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the real trick in some way is, can you, like you did, Vince, could you join be a first student or early student, excuse me, in someone's lab that then goes on to be that sort of famous big lab down the road? You kind of are getting on the ground floor
early on.
That's actually can be a really beneficial or useful position. Whereas, and I'm also not trying to discourage exploring more established or quote unquote famous labs. But if it's already, you know, someone who's kind of later in their career, it's, you know, 30 or 40 trainees, that's a really different experience field or a place where it might be pretty competitive. People are kind of carving out a piece of the pie of something that's pretty established versus that sort of ground level, almost startup company feel to a newer lab.
I mean, it depends on your personality also, you know,
That's right.
If you're going to get lost in a big lab, it's no good for you. If you need a little more attention, pick a smaller one. I mean, I had Peter's attention every day, right? Mm-hmm. And I loved it. I didn't. And other people came after me and they hated it.
Sure.
Right? So it depends on the person. But nobody ever paid attention to me, right? I felt like I went through college and nobody cared except my parents, right? And so to go in a lab and somebody's asking me every day, so what's new? Man, I loved it.
Yeah, that's cool.
Right?
Yep. Yep.
So
yeah, and it really depends on your scientific style and your interests too, because it could be
surely
that the question or the system or the resources that the only place to do that would be in a larger sort of environment or more established thing.
Sure.
And so it's a little dependent on what you're into and what you're doing. Yeah.
All right, we have one more here from Anthony. And he says, Tarzan and the Lion Man, 1933 book by Edgar Rice Burroughs. And he has a quote, which I guess is from the book, right?
Mm-hmm.
I had always been intrigued by Lamarck's investigations and later by Darwin's. They were on the right track, but they did not go far enough. Then shortly after my graduation, I was traveling in Austria when I met a priest at Brunn who was working along lines similar to mine. His name was Mendel. We exchanged ideas. He was the only man in the world who could appreciate me, but he could not go all the way with me. I got some help from him, but doubtless he got more from me, though I never heard anything more about him before I left England. I determined that heredity could be controlled through the transference of these genes from one individual to another. I learned that the genes never die. They are absolutely indestructible, the basis of all life on Earth, the promise of immortality throughout all eternity. End quote. And Anthony adds, might reading this have been the inspiration for crafting the fiction into fact? Now, Nels, I'm not quite sure I understand. Do you? Who is he talking about?
Yeah, I'm not sure, Anthony. You might have to help decode here. But I do like this quote, that second quote. So, determined that heredity could be controlled through the transference of these genes from one individual to another. This is echoing, I think, on our episode a bit.
Yeah.
That genes never die, indestructible, the basis of life. That sounds a little bit like, also has some hints of Richard Dawkins in there as well.
Yeah.
So moving the gene to the sort of unit of, evolution, as a unit of inheritance, that's sort of where the action is. That was a big transition. As for crafting fiction into fact,
man, I don't get it.
I don't, but I do like that notion of sort of mixing, swirling both art and science together. I think that, you know,
sure,
all these interesting things that can emerge from that. So if that's what you're getting at, Anthony, I'm with you.
But of course, 1933 is well after Mendel, so.
Correct.
It couldn't have influenced him. But maybe I'm reading it wrong, I'm sure. But thank you. Thank you for writing. And now let's do some picks.
Sounds great. And I have to say, I have to apologize. I have two picks. I couldn't resist.
No problem.
Okay. So we're running a little long here, but you know, fast forward if you just want one of my picks. So the first one that I chose is new species of snailfish. This kind of splashed the news, I guess, last week. I was in a raft in the Cataract Canyon on the Colorado River, so I missed it. But from Newcastle University, they've been launching these deep water probes and retrieval systems off the coast of Chile and Peru in the Atacama Trench, which gets up to 7 miles deep. I don't think their probes are going quite that deep, these little unmanned underwater vehicles. But they are getting super deep, and they've got these great video clips that they just released that have what they're describing as three new species of snailfish. There's a little video in the link from my pick of the week. And it's really fascinating. So I guess they were able, you'll see when they're deploying these things, they actually have bait. So they put like these fish carcasses, and then they get all these deep water critters that swim around, and they saw three new kinds of snailfish. Really interesting. They don't look like kind of the deep sea fish that you expect. They're a little more kind of squishy and translucent. Mm-hmm. I guess they were able to retrieve one, and it was relatively good shape. I was actually fascinated by the crustaceans that they observed,
yeah,
so-called monopsids.
Cool.
Those are really wild. Yeah. So anyways, it's cool. My sort of ulterior motive for doing this was, so I saw the first clip on Twitter yesterday, and it was put out there by one of my sort of science mentors, science heroes, a fellow named Alejandro Sanchez on Twitter. He's known as @Planaria1. So you mentioned Vincent Planaria early in our episode. Mm-hmm. Alejandro has been a pioneer of establishing or getting a foothold for planaria as a system for regeneration. You take these worms, cut them into like 130 pieces, and they just grow back without batting an eyelash. Mm-hmm. They can regenerate. So anyway, he's been doing a lot of the developmental biology, the genetics behind that in his own lab. He was here at Utah, and then right when I arrived, actually moved to the Stowers in Kansas, but continues to do all kinds of amazing and inspirational biology with planaria. Anyway, so his quote for that snailfish video was what I really wanted to share. And he says, "Each species embodies millennia of history, biological adaptations, and molecular tricks of complexity we cannot imagine nor readily predict. Mm. Every new species discovered is essentially a unique interpretation of the universe, worthy of our best efforts to understand it."
Totally.
Yeah. And kind of a guiding principle in a sense for TWEVO in some ways as well.
So the other day we were working on our virology textbook, and one of my colleagues called mosquitoes, I forgot the word he used, but basically commonplace it meant, right? And I said, I don't think anything living is commonplace, yeah, right? And that's what this is. Every species is a unique interpretation and worthy of our efforts. Everything living is cool. And my son asked me, well, do you like wasps and bees? I said, yeah, they don't like what they do if they sting you, but they're all worthy. They're amazing that they've evolved and become the way they are, right?
Yeah, that's right. And, you know, for this episode, for example, right? I mean, the strawberry, something very familiar. And yet, this new sort of mechanism of translocation involved in the sex chromosome. I mean, it's just almost any organism, as you go under the hood, there's just all of this fascinating biology. And so, yep, that's kind of what drives some of this. Okay, my second pick is, and I think we've talked about this, but I was looking back, because I thought I had done this as a pick of the week before, but I'm not sure that I did. So this is, I couldn't find it, the marbled crayfish. Does this ring a bell at all, Vincent? Have I talked about this on TWEVO in your memory? I might not have.
I don't think so, no.
Yeah, so this is one of my, maybe my favorite kind of weird science stories from the last year or so, is this crayfish that is now undergoing parthenogenesis. So this is basically So most crayfish, as we've been talking about, have males and females, and they mate. There is a line of marbled crayfish that is now parthenogenic, and this does not even mean self-fertilizing, so it doesn't have male and female parts. It means it can reproduce offspring without fertilizing the egg. Mm-hmm. So a female crayfish gained, marbled crayfish gained the ability to basically just reproduce without a male. And it's going, so I've got a link to a story. There, this kind of splashed the news early, like just around maybe February or something. This piece is in The Atlantic. It's from one of my favorite science writers, Sarah Zhang. And she describes how this thing emerged probably from a pet store, maybe in Texas, and then ended up in Germany, the clones. And so basically this crayfish has been cloning itself, I think since 95 or something like
amazing.
That.
Amazing.
And now it's, I mean, it's amazing. And also a little, from an ecological standpoint, a little bit of a mess. So it's gotten into, it's invading some ecosystems, some habitats where there are native crayfish, and in some cases potentially taking over. And remember, so it doesn't, it actually doesn't have that compromise where only half of its genes go into the next generation. It just clones itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so the prediction from the Red Queen hypothesis would be that, okay, you might get this short-term advantage from sort of short-circuiting the need to mate, but now the genetic diversity will be lower because these are basically mm-hmm. nearly identical mm-hmm. clones.
Sure.
And
yep. Yep.
at some point, these things might be susceptible.
Yeah. Sure.
To predators, to pathogens, microbes, whatever. And so that's kind of an ongoing, interesting experiment by the crayfish, whether or not this thing persists or how far it actually gets. Really wild story. The basis of, so how did it become? How did it flip that switch from mating to being parthenogenic? They've sequenced the genome. It's triploid, so it has mm-hmm. like our... Mm-hmm. So that might be a clue, but how that makes it parthenogenic is not clear, and there still that's a mystery. People are, I think, actively working on that.
Yeah, it's very cool. Very cool. But you're right. I think eventually it's going to crash at some point, although that may take a long time.
Yeah. 50,000 years, who knows?
Who knows, yeah.
That's really,
I mean, it's not going to happen in a year, right? Who knows?
That's right.
Yeah. Cool.
Okay. So anyway, so that's my pick of the week.
That's
kind
nice.
Of picks of the week. Kind of goes in the opposite direction of what we saw where the... self-fertilizing strawberries became male female. Here are the male female crayfish start mm-hmm. cloning itself. Mm-hmm. One of the females.
Cool.
How about you? Cool. Yeah. How about you, Vincent? What's your pick of the week?
Well, I have a blog post that I wrote, which is based on something I did yesterday. I was invited to Mount Sinai here in New York City. Their mm-hmm. PhD programs decided to have a lab coat ceremony. Now.
Mm.
Those of you who know medical schools may know that it's become a tradition in many medical schools in the country. When the first year medical students come, they have a ceremony where they give them a white coat and they recite the Hippocratic Oath and get them going, right? The families come and it's a nice ceremony. So that's mm-hmm. been called the white coat ceremony. And people at Sinai running the PhD program said, why don't we do this for PhD students? They tend to not get a lot of attention. And So they had the first one. It's the first one in New York City. Apparently, there are a few others in the country. But they gave all of the 30 or so new PhD students, you know, brand new lab coats in a lovely ceremony where they came on stage and they got a coat. And the coat has their name on it, and it's got Mount Sinai, you know, and all of that. And anyway, I was asked to give a keynote at this ceremony, which was very nice, quite an honor. And my post is basically my keynote, which I've posted there. And, you know, I love the idea of the lab coat ceremony. And I also love the idea of talking to brand new students because I have a lot of things to say. I entered the PhD program there.
Yeah.
As I said earlier, I was Peter's first student. I did 43 years ago. I started. So
wow, amazing. Yeah.
So this is my talk. And I just want everyone to think about this idea of doing this because... you know, the students were really excited to do this. They really had a good time, you know, and they get a nice looking lab coat. So if you're in a program, I would do it. I think it's cool.
Great idea. I really do like that, like marking kind of that transition or that the beginning of that. Not just, you know, we, of course there are PhD ceremonies when you're finished, but to sort of mark and celebrate that at the beginning. Yeah, what a great idea. Sure. Yeah.
And, you know, PhD students, they come and nobody pays attention and, yeah, okay, mm-hmm. find a lab, do a rotation, take some courses, right? So this is a good ceremony. I like it because,
yeah.
And, you know, there were a few other talks and the dean said, you know, you're going to make discoveries. You're important. You know, mm-hmm. we appreciate it. Yeah. And so it's a way of showing it.
Great idea. I think I'll start to circulate that idea around here, see if we get any traction.
Get a couple of listener picks, Nels. Why don't you take one?
Sure. So Steve writes, well, actually, it's a pick. So he sent along a nice link from Quanta magazine on an article entitled World's Simplest Animal Reveals Hidden Diversity. And so this is about an interesting critter called Trichoplax. And these Placozoa have, and Trichoplax in particular, so this gets at, I don't know, simplest is always a tricky word. It's slightly loaded. Like, what could it be? Slightly subjective.
Mm.
But, so these Placozoa, their ancestors split off from the chordates in ancient history, and then have been evolving since. They've remained as relatively simple animals, and what's happening in really fascinating animals that are, they look kind of like blobs, to be honest. They're not the most charismatic looking critters, but it's sort of a recurring theme here as people are starting to define the genetic diversity, the genomic diversity by doing genome scale analysis. Some really interesting hidden biology. And so, yeah, I agree. So thank you, Steve. This is it's a really interesting critter. I have a colleague here at Utah who's picking up Trichoplax as a potential system to think about origins of the nervous system. So they don't have a nervous system, but they have a lot of the key parts. This also sort of feels familiar from Nicole King's ideas of multicellularity with coenoflagellates. As people are sort of defining this diversity, what's the biology behind it? And I think there's a couple points I might just sort of make here. One is that, sort of, you know, this idea of, so these things have been evolving as long as we have. So trying to avoid that idea that they're quote unquote primitive. The split of our common ancestors was very ancient or a primitive event, but then we've kind of gone our own directions. It's sort of tempting to think that, you know, because we can talk, podcast, whatever else, that somehow this is like a pinnacle of evolution. However, those Trichoplax are pretty good at persisting themselves through a number of different diversifying strategies. And so this idea of, even though they might look like a blob, there's a lot of natural selection and things that have happened over the millions and millions of years and some really complicated biology. And having these comparison points can really help reveal sort of the secrets of evolution. So check that out. Yeah, I think that's a really nice pick. Thank you, Steve.
Don't underestimate a blob.
Maybe that could be, I like that as a title for the, and we'll keep an eye if there's any interesting papers on Trichoplax. That would be a fun,
yeah, it'd be cool.
That might be a fun podcast. Yep.
Well, we have another one from Justin. Dear Team Tuivo, I had a quick listener pick. For those who haven't stumbled onto this book, it's a fantastic classic. The book is On Growth and Form by Darcy Wentworth Thompson. The version I own is abridged and edited by John Tyler Bonner. And yes, is the same John Tyler Bonner of slime mold fame. Gives a link to that. Keep up the great work and don't shy away from the weird stuff. Have you read this, Nels?
No, I haven't. I'm just looking at it now on Amazon. Looks great.
This is, when was it published? 1917.
Mm.
Why do living things and physical phenomena take the form they do? The classic On Growth and Form looks at the way things grow and the shapes they take, analyzing biological processes and their mathematical and physical aspects. Has become renowned for the sheer poetry of its descriptions.
Hmm.
All right.
Yeah, good idea. Good good pick. And yeah, a lot of fodder maybe for other, like, jumping fleas, slipper limpets, B cells, raindrops, what's going on? Like, there's a lot under the surface here that are worth considering in the, as we do on the show. another
thing. Although, you know, it's not going to have anything about homeoboxes, but, you know, which is a big part of form.
Yeah, development as defined by our more close relatives, right?
Yeah, but something like this might be fun to read. So thanks, Justin.
Yeah, thanks, Justin.
All right, that'll do it for Tweevo number 35. It's at Apple Podcasts, microbe.tv/Tweevo. It's on Google Play. If you listen to podcasts on your phone or tablet, you know you have an app that you use. Please subscribe, and you get every episode, and it helps with our numbers. If you subscribe, really helps us a lot. And if you like what we do, go to microbe.tv/contribute, as Tom suggested. You know,
yeah,
you could take that $1 from your candy bar a month and give it to us. That would really help. Microbe.tv/contribute, and of course, questions, comments, suggestions, listener picks, tweevo@microbe.tv. Nels Eldy is at cellvolution.org. He's on Twitter, L Early Bird. Thanks, Nels.
Thank you, Vincent. Great to do it again. 35. We're getting up there.
Yeah, 35. Pretty soon we'll be at 500, right?
Not too shabby.
I'm Vincent Dracaniello. You can find me at virology.ws. Music on Tweevo is by Trampled by Turtles. They're at trampledbyturtles.com. Been listening to This Week in Evolution, the podcast on the biology behind what makes us tick. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next month. Till then, be curious.